So,
well, we are back in action. So, now we are going to talk a bit contemporary classical music, yeah? So, first of all, I would like to cover the topic of coherence creation, the creation of coherence. In the 20th century, the aesthetic paradigm of music changed, yeah, as you very well know, and common practice was tend to be abandoned purposely, yeah. So people said there is nothing else to do. Was this a musical restricted attitude? It wasn't. Was not. It happened everywhere. In architecture, in painting, in sculpture, the arousal of conceptual art as well, like the one we see now in Tate's Modern, yeah? All that happened, yeah, in a short period of time, yeah? There, people can say, we never know when precisely it started happening, but it happened in the first half of the 20th century. Yeah, it continued to develop and it continued to fade into the beginning of the 21st century, and now we are seeing the recession, yeah, of that extremely radical perspective on the common practice in all the arts, yeah, not only in music. The generation of my parents, that could be a bit like your grandparents, and I'm a bit in between, yeah, was a generation of the new. Generation of the new. The generation of America. Yeah? America was better, was best, was better than old and stinky Europe. And therefore, everything that we did with craftsmanship, with effort, effort was the mode. Effort. Why should someone make an effort? No, we shouldn't make an effort. We should actually do no effort and get a lot of rubbish up and use that rubbish, which is effortless. And we did that. We destroyed the palaces. We destroyed the valuable architecture we had in the capitals. Some countries did more than others. Actually, Greece and Spain are some of the countries that did the most. In the center of Athens, for example, a lot of old buildings from the Belle Époque were removed. The same in Spain. In Spain, a lot of the valuable architecture was removed from the face of Earth and replaced with hideous 60s and 70s intranscendent objects that now dirtifies the landscape of our capitals, no, of these capitals. So the same happened in music. In music we started creating coherence, new coherence, and effortless coherence. Of course, I will take the bill out of that, right? I'm an artist, I throw just a pile of rubbish into another bag of empty, and now this is my way of expressing myself, and it's self-indulgent, because yes, it might be for the first person that thought about it, yeah, that was with a purpose, it might be an artistic object. But not for anyone else that after this person did it and found that that was easy, did it as well. Yeah, that we have to draw a line there between what is really, really original, really valuable 20th century production and what is not. Yeah. It's just repetition of something that is just effortless, and that's why it was repeated, yeah? Because it was easy to be repeated, yeah? Creativity is the same, always. It's the same, in everything. Actually, it's the same thing. The good music is an expression of creativity. Painting is an expression of the same sort of creativity. Good work is the same, is the expression of the same sort of creativity. So one second, let me just bring my cat out of the office. Let me start. Sorry for that. So basically, everything that you do is an expression of yourselves. Yeah. So when, for example, yesterday, no, when we had this conversation about the emails, no, and I will go straight to the emails side of things, or the article, no, in which you asked me, Georgios, what should I write in the article? Well, that's the creation of coherence. At the end of the day, that's the project I have with you three, not to teach you the extension. And by pushing the extension in your brains, you start replicating the, no. My dream would be for you to learn how to create something that is coherent, a system, to be able to create systems of things, yeah? Of system that can be translated in a sonata, system that can be translated into a beautiful and coherent performance, systems that we can translate into quick and perfectly systematic articles, or very successful emails. It's all the same thing. Yeah, it's just looking for a system that makes sense, that connects and relates concepts, finds similarities, and builds relationships. Yeah. When you are confronted with a blank page, yeah, you are confronted, just 1 second, please. You're confronted with something that is not systematized, right? Something that doesn't have any concepts on itself, that they are evidently not related, yeah? And you have to make a choice of what are you going to be talking about, what can be branched out from that main objective of what you are talking about, yeah? And how those things that you choose that branch out build up the main concept and relate to each other. That's it. Yeah? So, we're going to start. Have you listened to Hofmeier yesterday? Well, we're going to listen to Hofmeier now, again. It's a very short piece, but it comes with the score, so it's a perfect, example. So, let me see. Hopefully, I will not be, I claim no authority on the Hofmeier piece, obviously. I'm saying that it's made by Hofmeier, and we are just going to use the score that he himself published. So I think we are not anything on the YouTube, so we are not infringing any copyright. So let's see.
Thank you.
Well, leaving religious implications behind on a side, the reason I choose this this piece is because Hofmeyr is the winner of one of the Queen Elizabeth the competitions. Precisely, he's the winner of the Queen Elizabeth competition 1997 with a piece called Raptus, and he's from South Africa. And that's why, coming from South Africa, he got very wisely immersed in the world of choir writing. Yeah, it's obviously African voices are particularly colorful in terms of all the ranges that they can produce, and the women voice is particularly beautiful with all its different ballet of sounds they can make. And obviously, in a country which is which doesn't have probably a strong tradition in symphonic music, etc., everyone can sing, right? So it's very inclusive as well. So I think that it was strategically the way to go around doing academic music there for him. He's approximately between 60 and 70 years old. And he became one of the best writers in the world, composers in the world for choral music. So, well, in terms of the way that it is written, in terms of the supporting columns of this aesthetic, first of all is the harmony, yeah? Conventional, yeah, in all its length, yeah, the length of a piece, it's tonal. I like the fact that he related void with fifths, yeah? So when they say void, they normally it's a void chord, yeah, with tonic and fifth. He creates this sense of instability of, or he uses the dissonance as a color, as a leitmotif as well, several times, yeah? The dissonance has a strong impact on choral music when we use it, yeah? Because of the sustained properties of choral music, no? You can somehow extend the duration of a note almost indefinitely with divisi, no? So for example, if you take the bass, the bass, you divide, split it, no? And you can support the... Which is something that you could do in the orchestra as well, but it's less common, yeah? In choral music is quite common practice. And also extended techniques in the shape of whispers, air, breathings, and the very unconventional polyphonic singing, yeah, which there makes the day for the piece, I think. It's incidental in all its extension, so it's at the service of the text, this piece. It has internal coherence. So if we took off the text, we would be taking 30-40% of the coherence from the piece. But still, yeah, musically speaking, it has its sections, and it can still be musically analyzed purely. Yeah, and it would make sense, particularly the beginning and the end, yeah, which is perfectly logical. Yeah, the point of departure, the point of arrival. So well, we will do a bit of music appreciation before I identify the resources. Yeah, I try to make down notes of the resources so you can use it in your pieces in the future. Yeah, and we have a session on this choral music by Hofmeyr. So, in terms, Georgios, what got your attention? Yeah, in mainly morphology, or what do you think is the logic behind it? What sort of motivic resources you see deployed? And what are the patterns that you could perceive?
I didn't analyze the melody so much, but the techniques themselves were mostly determining the passage, the moment, the form. There was a moment that they were singing, the moment that they were blowing wind, the moment that they were whispering. That's how it's kind of structured in my head when I listen to it. The text really changed the... I don't even know how he used chords, in what form, but that was the guide, the text, a lot. That, I've never heard it before, so it really caught my attention, by the way, that winged effect. Now, how it structured, I didn't understand from the first, with the first glance, I'm not sure.
Well, yes. There are two main sections in the piece. One that talks about the chaos, and one that talks about the creation of order. Yeah, there is an inflection point within the piece, you know, that is mainly impersonated by these tutis, no, or these very long chords, stable chords, where everyone sings, and everyone tends to sing in a clear major chord. Right? So it's very contrasting, no, to this sort of wingling harmonic textures that he deploys. There's always this moment in which everything makes sense, yeah, harmonically speaking, in a different way. Whispers. The whispers in this case are used mainly as an incidental resource, a special effect. Yeah, if it was in the computer, we would have used some sort of special effect in Logic or something. He himself, he creates that special effect by using this extended technique. He uses it very sustainably, very, very consistently, so it doesn't sound like a sporadic, yeah, so it basically tames the whole aesthetic of the piece, and in that sense it's very well used. And what I wanted to derive from that, besides of the whisper itself, and obviously the symbol that I would like you to take notes of, so you can use it in your pieces, that symbol that he uses is very clear, yeah, that way of, now we're going to see. I would like you to bear in mind that every time that you use an effect in one of your pieces, yeah, it's advisable that you use it consistently. Not just consistently because you repeat it along with a huge array of different effects. Because actually there shouldn't be a big profusion of effects. You should bet to one or two and use them. Yeah? He bet to what? To whispers and polyphonic singing. And it was clear when he was using one or both of them, but it wasn't chaotic the way it was used. It was very clear, your attention was drawn, you could hear it, the whisper. It wasn't shadowed by conventional writing on top of it in an overwhelming way for the effect. Yeah, the effect was portrayed, yeah, it was shown to people. That's why it catches so much attention of everyone when we listen to it. No, automatically our attention is driven there. The polyphonic singing as well is interesting the way he used it, because it's very faint. When someone sings polyphonically, it's not a very bold sound, so it requires the composer to make space, because whatever you put on top would take off the power, no, of that effect. As Rubinstein say in one interview, he says, people pay attention when we play pianissimo more than when we play fortissimo, because they have to make an effort to listen, otherwise they will miss something. Yeah, so automatically attention is driven to the void of sound. Yeah, so always keep that in mind when you write music. Yeah, in the same way as you balance the registers, treble and bass, you should balance the intensities, forte and piano. Yeah, and everything that is in between. In between, everything is neutral. Middle register means the register is neutral. Yeah, mezzo forte means we are not talking about dynamics. Yeah, legato in piano, I want to say something too rough, no? I don't want to make a bad general, everything has to be seen in context, no? But I'm trying to draw a big line here. But in general, no? In general, common practice, legato, you're not talking about articulation in piano. Yeah, so these sort of things have to be very clear. For you performers like Laura, pure performers, you need to keep an eye on that. if Beethoven is writing in the middle register, maybe there is something else going on. Yeah, maybe there, it's about counterpoint, or it's about articulation. Or is it? You know what I mean? If it's too much in legato, the same thing. No, maybe it's about the register. Yeah, so we need to try to enhance that as performance. No, put that in front of the. If we are doing piano subito, then that's the most important thing. We have to make sure that piano subito is successful, yeah, when we produce it, and not tame it and bring it ratio wise too close to the to when we play forte, yeah. So this sort of duties as performers, yeah, and Iris and Georgios as composers, the same. Yeah, be clear to your performers. Yeah, don't make it too difficult. Yeah, if you mix up things, then Laura, for example, will not know what you are trying to do. Yeah, and will not be able to spontaneously produce the results that you expect her to produce. Yeah. So in terms of text, text and the voice itself. Is the most complex of instruments, the voice. Yeah, no other instrument can produce text. The violin can't speak. Can it? The piano can't speak either. Yeah, everything else is very compromised. The voice is the most perfect of sounds. Yeah, of instruments. Each note that we produce, each vowel that we produce, each consonant, has its challenges for the voice. And it will affect our ability to produce certain vowels is affected by the register. That's what I wanted to say. So, not all, because actually the experience of a vowel, yeah, being the closed vowels, U, O, then we have E, E, so going from closed to open, U, O, E, E, A, U, O, E, E, A. The more we go to the closed vowels, the more low frequencies we need to make them happen. Yeah, the vowels are, alchemistry speaking, are a mix of different frequencies. Yeah, is, I don't know if you understand what was your fantasy about how a vowel sounds like a vowel. Why do you thought A sounded like A, or O sounded like O? Do you have any idea?
I'm confused. What's the question?
When you're talking, what do you think that makes the A sound like an A and the O sound like an O?
The shape of the mouth.
Yes, the shape of the mouth producing what? What is going to do the shape of the mouth? It will affect the sound.
Yes, no?
How? By changing what? By changing the harmonics, by changing the partials, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
It's like an instrument, yeah. If you take the oboe sounds more like an O. No, ooh, like a duck. The flute sounds more like a bird. Like a the small birds, the sparrows, yeah? And therefore, everything in the structure of a flute is more towards the treble, yeah? The clarinet is a jigsaw, yeah, of harmonics, actually. Obviously, the leading tone, the leading bass frequency, is the frequency of the tone we are singing. Yeah, that overrides the sound itself. But every sound has a primordial compound and a timbre compound. Yeah, they're both things coexist. The note itself, do, obviously is do, yeah? But then the timbre is all the rest that surrounds that main frequency. You understand? We will go on that a bit more deeper in the next lesson.
Is that possible?
Sorry?
Never. You've blown my mind now. How is this possible? We do this when we use different vowels?
Yes, we do. Even when you talk.
have to study this now.
You have to. If you were studying composition in the university, you would have two modules, compulsory modules, at least in the glorious University of Buenos Aires, you would have two modules of acoustics. Yeah, actually going very deep on all the phenomena with mathematics involved in it and everything, so you could understand that with certain level of depth. I will try to give you a digested version of that, yeah, so you can guide your own research, yeah, if you want to pursue it. I think it's very important, and I think it's the key to understand the new aesthetics of contemporary classical music, which explores that, the construction of sound, yeah? So, why I went to the choir? Because in the choir, you have it done for you. It's like a fast food of construction of sound. Because you just ask this computer, which are the singers, to do whatever you want. And you don't have to bother in having to program a computer to produce what you want. Yeah, you just explain to these very smart computers, the singers, what you want, and they will try to do it. Yeah. So, vowels. The vowels will have different harmonics, different partials, different frequencies that they will need to happen. Yeah. For that reason, it's very difficult for a soprano to sing a top C with a U. Yeah. It's almost impossible. That's why amor, the word amore, in Italian, sounds amara when someone sings it, because it's so dangerous to actually try and place the O when it's very high, obviously, when it's very, very, very high, when it's very, very, very high, yeah? It will sound everything like an A, because it's the only way the singer can actually produce, and that's why it's so upsetting sometimes to listen to Italian opera. Because you can't understand anything of what they're saying. Did it happen to you? When you listen to opera, you can't understand what the singers are saying. Sometimes.
No, you play it. Yes, I can think of someone singing Amore very high, and it sounds like Ama. It's true. You have blown my mind now.
Exactly. They have to just say with the vowel that has more frequency. So then we open the grounds of what they call a dark. O or an open O. A dark O would be an O, like in the bass. If he can do the bass, the bass can do the O beautifully. Yeah, I mean, he would actually want an O in the text, but would really struggle, really horribly struggle to do an A down there. Yeah, and the soprano would struggle a lot to say amore up there in the C5, C6, yeah? C5, maybe. I don't want to say something terrible. I don't know if the soprano can reach actually a C6. But hopefully, I think she can reach a C6. But anyway, amore. Why I picked up on the word amore? Because it's so much used in the opera. Which opera doesn't have the word amore? Right? And being so much used, you can see the deformation of this word almost instantaneously when you listen to any opera, particularly Italian opera, Bel Canto, up there, so the composers want a beautiful C6, exactly, C6 or D with amore and the soprano does amare. So, when you write music, in contemporary classical music, it wouldn't be wise to maybe place the word amore in there, in the heights, because you know that the singer will not be able to sing it, yeah? So then, the extended techniques and the way we manage the choir relates to this knowledge, yeah? We really have to, yeah, obviously Verdi knew it too, yeah? But he had different priorities. So nowadays, yeah, you need to use the resources very technically. Yeah, that's the trick. Yeah. In terms of what Hofmeier tells us with this piece, he's telling us we can still write in tonal music. Yeah, let's go to the piece itself. Just one second. Can you see it? Yes. You see, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's look at this first line. So in this first line, we say, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Yeah, brought from, I insist, I don't have any particular, I didn't choose it for religious reasons. Yeah, I'm just, it comes for this, if anyone has any susceptibility on that sense. Yeah, it's musically chosen. So, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Yeah, the beginning. Beginning related to what? To statism. There is a concept that you need to read on your own spare time, maybe you can write an article about it, synesthesia. Do you know what synesthesia means?
To mix the senses. Is that what it is?
Yes, say it with an example so everyone can understand it.
To listen to colors.
And see sounds. Yes, exactly. When you compose for a text, you have to be synesthetic. So you try to create analogies constantly, yeah? So the beginning, he related with statism, particularly the creation of the universe. If you think about the Big Bang, no, it's, there's nothing, there's no movement, there is no variety, there is no mainly movement. And we can see clearly how he interpreted the sense of no movement by keeping what? What is there in the beginning?
One. Single note?
A single note, a unison. Yeah? It's not a unison because they are in different octaves, yeah? But it couldn't be a unison because everyone is singing on different registers, so it wouldn't be a unison. I think that if it could be a unison, it would be a unison. Yeah? There is no harmony. In such, no? There is no real development in harmony. There is only rhythm. And the rhythm is derived from what? From the text. And we can see that the fact that he's subduing the rhythm to the text in that he even bends the metric to fulfill the text accentuation. Yeah? Here he changed the bar to 2-4. Yeah, because he needed an accent there. So ta 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 ta. Yeah? He needed there, so he somehow bring it up with the with changing the bar line, no? And in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. Yeah? In English is not the best language for opera, yeah, because it has too many consonants, the same as German, yeah, all Saxon-derived languages are not the best languages for opera, though Mozart proved the opposite, obviously, being one of the best composers in Germanic tone, yeah, and many others, but it's a great opportunity, yeah, in this English language to actually have a vowel. So he explored that, and if we check, yeah, it's all unison.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. God created.
Then, extended techniques. Well, he wanted chaos in the way, no? Everything was, the particles of this Big Bang were just crashing with each other, no? And there was a sense of disorganization. Would have made sense to write a taxative account of what a chaos, of how a chaos would be represented in notes. Would that be worthwhile for him as a composer? To write in quavers, semi-quavers, semi-quavers, and create there a rhythm that would be a headache for the singer to try to reproduce. So what he did instead is say, look, I want disorder. So he trebled the notes, yeah? He tremolo, yeah, yeah. The notes, he said, say this, repeat freely, God created the heaven and the earth. You know, just have to say it, speak it, almost speak it with a lot of air, right? And we count the tempo, right? With different accentuations, different entries, you see? The la, the unison, yeah, prolongs in case of, here we have a huge divisi of the soprano, remember I told you about the divisi? And in this way he can sequence the entries, so the entries are organized and very clear, it's not difficult. Yeah, it's in a crotchet, it's not in a semi-demi quaver in a stupid place, basically. It's clearly crotchet, no, in a sequence. No, we start crotchet, crotchet. Here it doesn't happen. In the extremes it doesn't happen. Yeah, until here. Right? Or actually, it happens at the very beginning. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah, 6, 7, 8, yeah, all of the voices. So resources: divisi to support the notes seamlessly, so the voice seems to be having an infinite breathing, an infinite fiato. The term is fiato, yeah, for the phrase, yeah. The legato and the slurs take a completely different dimension in choral music than in piano, yeah. The fiato, the air, actually, we have to be very conscious when we create a slur, when we place a slur for the voice, because it will mean that they can breathe in between, yeah. So we have to make sure that it's doable, yeah. And if it's not doable, as in the case of Hofmeyer's prolongation, it's only divisi. So then they can still make the same effect. Divisi is fantastic. Why? Because anything that is unnatural but seems natural catches the attention. So for the audience, listening to something that prolongs, a single note prolonging and seeming to come from the same group of singers, it's curious. Yeah. So it will automatically catch the fascination of the audience, yeah. And then, well, we create this extended technique with this spoken language, yeah, on tremolo. We don't really care that much about how they do it, in as far as they do it sequenced and not evenly, yeah. Contemporary pieces as well require a lot of intervention from the composer and the conductor, because not everything is written. We are seeing the boundaries of music notation here. Yeah? Okay, so then. I told you, we showcase one element of music at a time. Dynamics. That's it. So all the mess stops. Dynamics. Piano subito. And we leave everything steady. So people can pay attention to us wanting to do piano subito. We don't do piano subito in between an array of different intentions, yeah? Everything you do in music is an intention. You intend to, so have one intention always at a time. Try to keep one intention, particularly now that you're novice composers, yeah? Just one intention, just freeze everything. It's like when you play the piano, look, always remember the analogy. When we play the piano, what we try to do? To relax everything that is not involved in the act of moving up a finger, no? That's the main challenge we have with finger move. In composition, it's the same gesture. Just one thing, clearly done. The rest, don't disturb. Yeah? And then you reach high aesthetics. Yeah? This wonderful simplicity. Yeah? The dynamic, once is showcased, piano pianissimo, it remains untouched. Piano pianissimo. Then we do harmonic changes. So now, harmony. F is rather more consonants than without form. So shape and chaos is related with what?
Again?
Yes. F is consonants. Is more consonants than without form. So then, what are we... Chaos. Chaos and shapelessness is related to what? What is the analogy in this work?
Dissonance consonants.
Dissonance, exactly. Dissonance. Sometimes in the shape of a very strict dissonance, or this, no, this sort of confusion, no, that he tried to produce in the previous bar. Again, polyphonic singing. We made the decision, take the decision, do a polyphonic singing, nothing else. Polyphonic singing for 2-3 bars. When that topic is clear, we go into something else, slowly. Dark, chaos, or whatever keeps us restless, dissonance. We build coherence. We build a system, something that can communicate at the end of the day. We can see the pattern and we can see what things mean. And with this I want to close the lesson. We create meaning. The act of composing music and the act of doing something well is the act of creating meaning. Why do we say something is important when it's meaningful? We do something in a meaningful way.
Mm.
10 minutes of break and we will do Scaramuzza.